It is Friday, the 5th of February 2021. Welcome to the 13th lecture in Letters Boltzmann Methods. Now, after spending an entire semester of learning how not to do Letters Boltzmann, we finally arrive at how to do Letters Boltzmann. Okay. Just one moment until the mic is turned on. So, welcome. Okay, today we talk about the cumulant Letters-Boltzmann methods. Content is the binomial transform between raw moments and central moments. Breakdown of Galilean invariance of the Letters-Boltzmann method in MRT. Then we revisit the independence of random variables. Yeah, what does this actually mean, and how this leads us to build an MRT model with cumulants instead of moments? Okay, so this is the plan for today, but before we actually start, I have the reminder that what we last time ended on. So last time we discovered that we had a problem with the forced order moments in MRT, where we had to choose a special relationship between two moments. So there was this moment M2 M211, yeah, and in order to eliminate the interdependence of the moments. Oops. In MRT, we had to relax this strange guy, which was M211 minus theta M011 instead of M211 alone. So of course M211 is a raw countable moment, yeah, so this is non-orthogonalized. If we relax this guy, then we observe overdamping in the system, so we have very large errors. If instead we use the orthogonal version of it, as it is usually done in the classical MRT methods, we have underdamping, and with this we see instability if we go to a smaller viscosity. So we have either a problem on one side or a problem on the other side. So either too much damping or too little damping, and we have more or less the right damping. Yeah, no problem if we choose this. Okay, but this is just a single observation on a single moment. Yeah, so to see, this is something that we saw by chance. So this is what we ended last time with. And now, of course, the question is, we found one problem. Are there other problems? Yeah. So what about other interdependences? In say higher moments, so this is one problem, and the other problem where we spent the first part of the lecture today is whether the frame of reference matters. So what do we mean by frame of reference? So as we learned, the classical MRT method that uses raw moments, so usually orthogonalized raw moments, and raw moments are of course taken in an Eulerian frame. There's also a different method, which is sometimes called the cascaded Lattice-Boltzmann method or the central moment Lattice-Boltzmann method. This is basically central moment MRT. So just instead of using these raw moments in MRT, you can also use central moments in MRT. Yeah, central moments. Central, and they, okay, so this goes by the name, they use central moments. And this is, of course, the Lagrangian frame. So how do they differ? Let's say this is raw. Raw is Eulerian. So raw moments, we call them M to distinguish them, M, A, B, C. This is defined over I, J, K. I by the power of A, J by the power of B, K by the power of C in F, I, J, K. So this is the raw Eulerian, and then there's the central, and they are Lagrangian. And they, okay, we call them K, K, A, B, C, K, A, B, C. Now they are defined as I, J, K, the sum over all I, J, K, indices of the lattice, I minus U, X, so the velocity in X direction, okay, formally divided by the lattice velocity, so divided by C, so that it becomes an integer. But very often we take, that we eliminate the unit, I mean. So this by A, J minus U, Y by C by the power of B, and K minus U Z divided by C by the power of, what is it, C, and this into, so no space anymore, this into, wait, why don't we use the technique that we have? Because it's so annoying. Doesn't take up. So, will you close this? Close. You know, the technology is just amazingly annoying. Can you close this? No, it can't. Okay. Now this will now be forever, I guess. So gone. Times F, no. F I J K. Okay. So this is the raw Eulerian and the Lagrangian moments. Okay, sometimes we want to express one of them in the other, and there's a very useful way of doing this. There's the binomial transform. Now, as you see, this here is just a polynomial in these guys here. And this binomial transform can be used to translate between frames of reference. And this basically looks like this. The equation is looks a bit annoying, especially in three dimensions. So it's the sum over j from zero. So now this j has nothing to do with the j up here, just running out of letters. Yeah, j equal to zero to a, the sum from no, this was not j, sorry. It's I. J equal to zero from zero to b, and k equal from zero to c, yeah, onto the binomial a I. B, J, and C, K. Now we have a minus 1 by the power of A minus I plus B minus J plus C minus K. And all of this multiplied, so now I'm really running out of space, so all of this multiplied by M, I, J, K, so this is the Ra moment, times M 1, 0, 0 divided by M 0, 0, 0 by the power of A minus I, M 0, 1, 0 divided by M 0, 0, 0 by the power of B minus J times M 0, 0, 1 divided by M 0, 0, 0 to the power of K, C minus K. Okay, so now this is the way we compute, we can directly compute central moments from Ra moments. And this binomial, yeah, this of course, binomial, this is of course defined as A over I, this is A factorial divided by I factorial, A minus I factorial. Yeah, okay, so this is just the standard definition here. Okay, to make life a little bit simpler, we will now look at these things in 2D, yeah, so that we don't have to write too many indices. And let us look at K20, which when we apply this equation gets out to M20 minus M10 squared divided by M00, which of course is M20 minus UX square rho. The moment, the other second moment, K11 is equal to M11 minus UX UY rho. So also the, now what we observe here, for example, that M20 equilibrium, yeah, I guess we have derived this, M20 equilibrium, this is ux square plus theta rho, and you see that this means that K20 equilibrium is equal to theta rho. So, and actually what you observe is that by definition, the equilibria, I think I should write this down, equilibria of central moments do not depend on velocity. Yeah, so the reason for this is that central moments are taken in a frame in which velocity is zero. Yeah, so they cannot depend on velocity. Otherwise, it would preach of Galilean invariance. What Galilean invariance is, we'll discuss this in a few minutes. Okay. Now, does it matter? So this was our initial question. Does it matter whether we... Does anybody know how I can turn this off? So this, does it matter whether we relax moments in the Eulerian frame of reference or the Lagrangian frame of reference? Yeah? And for looking at this, we start with the expression of the relaxation of Ra moments expressed in central moments. Okay, now look, let us look at this. We have, for example, this moment M20, yeah? And we look at the post-collision state of this. M20 is the pre-collision state plus omega20, which with which I want to indicate that this is the relaxation rate for this particular moment, yeah? So if you... listen carefully to me. The last time, you know that we usually do not relax M20 alone, but we form this combination M20 plus M02. Yeah, but this is not the point now, and I want to skip over this because otherwise it's getting too complicated. Now let us assume that this moment is now relaxed in this way. So what would this mean for the relaxation of the central moments? If we say, okay, we relax the Ra moments, and now we replace all of the appearances of this Ra moments by their central moment counterparts. Yeah, and here we recognize that there are three forms of the same moment, namely the pre-collision, the post-collision, and of course the equilibrium. Yeah? And all of them will now be replaced by pre-collision, post-collision, and equilibrium of the central moment. Okay, let's just do this. So this would mean that we have K20 post-collision, yeah, plus, now up here we have we have defined what it is. Yeah, so this we put into here. Now for the velocity part, yeah, there's the velocity part, ux, uy, and rho. Now these things here are conserved. And because they are conserved, they are the same in equilibrium, in pre-collision, and in post-collision. So they will always appear the same, to be the same. So now this is now equal to the pre-collision, of course, plus ux, uy, and rho, plus the collision part, omega 2, 0. Now comes k 2, 1, equilibrium. And here again, as I said, in equilibrium, this part here is the same because these things are conserved. minus k2 0 minus ux uy rho. Okay, now what do we see? We see that because these things are conserved, they drop out and this guy drops out. So we have k2 0 equals to post-collision equals to k2 pre-collision plus omega 2 k2 0 equilibrium minus k2 0. Okay, and this means that here in this case, Euler and Lagrange frames give the same results for the second order moments. So we just check the second order. To be more precise, we only checked one of the second order methods, but I tell you without showing that this also applies to what K11 and M11. So they would be the same thing. So to the second order, there is no difference. At the moments of the second order moments, there is no difference between the Lagrangian frame and the Eulerian frame. So we can easily use the Eulerian frame, so there's no problem with this at this point. Okay, but the reason was that we used, the reason was that these guys here, which make the difference between the Eulerian and the Lagrangian frame, they are conserved. And this is not necessarily the case for all of the moments. It is just the case for this moment. Now let us look at the next order moment, namely the third moment. So unfortunately, we have to write, there's a lot of writing now going on, because this central moment K21, it's only the third order moment, and I have to tell you in Lattice Boltzmann, we usually deal with up to the sixth order moment, So we are now only at the third order moment, and you see already it's getting kind of more complicated. Ux M11 minus Uy M20 plus 2 Ux square Uy rho. Now, in the previous moments that we had, so in the moment K20, the difference between the Ra and the central moments was only the velocity, a term in velocity, which was a conserved term. So it would be the same pre-collision, post-collision, and equilibrium. Now here, we have some terms which are not conserved. So this guy here would be conserved. But these two guys, they are not conserved. So now question, does this make a difference in the relaxation? Let's have a look, by the way, for simplification, we will replace M11 by K11 plus ux uy rho and k21 by m21 by k21 plus ux square rho. So this now and now we solve for m21 and put everything in here, and then we have m21. Now we take this to the other side. This is why we'll change sign now here, and we plug these guys into it. So what we end up with is m21 is mk2 plus. Now I'm looking at my notes, which I hope is correct. 2ux k11 plus uy k20 plus ux square uy rho. Yeah, so this is what is m21, and you see it's quite a bit longer than in the case of second order moments. Okay, now we do the relaxation. We do the relaxation in the Euler frame. Relaxation in the Euler frame. So if we relax M21 in the Euler frame, so then this would be the post-collision state, is the pre-collision state. Pre-collision state plus, say, okay, we have a relaxation rate coupled to this moment being omega 21, yeah, m21 equilibrium minus m21. Okay, now we have to unfortunately replace all these m21s by this entire equation. So we'll see, this is a kind of okay, we need enough space for this. Say, okay, we have K21. So we replace all the pre-collision states, yeah, plus UX. And now this here also, because we replace the entire moment, then this K11. This is also pre-collision state, yeah? Usually ux would also be pre-collision state, but ux is a conserved quantity, so it doesn't change between pre- and post-collision state, yeah? So, but K11, this is a non-conserved quantity. So, okay, plus uy k2, non-conserved, so we need the pre-collision, plus ux square uy rho, which is conserved, so it doesn't matter pre or post collision. So this was the left-hand side of this equation. Now write the right-hand side, which will not fit in a single line, yeah? But let's start with the, okay, is this visible? Okay, so we start with, sorry, yeah, so we start now with this guy. Okay, so this here goes out like this, and the yellow part, this will be now here. So this of course looks the same. It's just the pre-collision state. Okay, just write the pre-collision state. And then we have the collision part, which, okay, I'm running out of colors, will be this one. And this, comes now here. So this goes with plus omega 21. And this is first of all, the equilibrium part. So now everything here comes in equilibrium state. And then again, we subtract the pre-collision state. So this is K1, 2 plus UX, K1, 1 plus UY, K2, 0 plus UX square UY rho. So sorry for those long equations. Okay, so what do we recognize? We recognize that this part that is that only depends on conserved moments, which is here and here, yeah, on both sides of the equation, they disappear. And here we have, no, here I, what did I do? Wait. So I, there's supposed to be a minus. Okay, so here, this will cancel with this guy, yeah, but the other ones will not cancel because they are equilibrium compared to pre-collision. So we can now, okay, so this is what we have here. What we are now using, so in between, now we make use of the fact that we know the post-collision state of K2-1, yeah, we recognize this is the same if we do it in the Lagrangian or in the Eulerian frame. So we can write this here in the Lagrangian frame. This is K2-0 after collision plus omega 2-0 K2-0 equilibrium minus K2-0. And we also have K1-1 is K1-1 plus omega 1-1. Okay, they should usually be the same, but this is not the point now. K1-1 equilibrium minus K1-1 pre-collision. Okay, so and this now goes into the equation up there. Yeah, so this will be K. K2-1 after collision plus UX. Now, okay, what we see is that there is a, here is a pre-collision part now on the right-hand side, which automatically cancels with the pre-collision state on the left-hand side of the equation. This is on the left-hand side, and we cancel it on the right-hand side. Yeah, and I don't want to write the entire equation because otherwise I'm filling thousands of pages here. So I already subtracted this, yeah, and just write the solution. So if you're very interested, you can, of course, repeat this calculation, and then you see in all detail. Okay, so this is the left-hand side, and now the right-hand side, where I already said we already subtracted the pre-collision state. So we only have the pre-collision state of the K2-1. And then we get omega 1-2. Now this omega 1-2 is from the left-hand side. Sorry. Why do I have problems with this direction? So it is from the right-hand side of the previous equation. So it's the omega 2-1, where we have K2-1 equilibrium minus K2-1. Yeah, and now I write it this way, that I take out ux. Yeah, so this is for the collision, it's a constant, so I can take this out. And here we get 2 ux omega 2-1 k now 1-1 equilibrium minus k 1-1. minus UY omega to 1 K to 1 equilibrium minus K to 0 minus K to 0. Yeah, sorry. Okay, and now we take everything that's on the left-hand side to the right-hand side and rewrite this equation as just the post-collision part of the K2-1. K2-1 post-collision is K2-1 plus omega 2-1 K2-1 equilibrium minus K2-1. So this basically is this part here and this part here. But then we also have plus ux omega omega 2-1 minus omega 1-1. So because this is the difference between what we had on the left-hand side and the right-hand side in K1-1 equilibrium minus K 1-1 pre-collision plus UY omega 2-1 minus omega 2-0 in K2-0 equilibrium minus K2-0. Okay, so what is this? So up this here is what we would do if we will relax central moments directly in the Lagrangian frame. Okay, so if we just relax the central moments, we would have this thing. Now we discover that instead of relaxing central moments, we are relaxing Ra moments, we get something else. We get these things here. And these things here, unfortunately, they depend. So the relaxation of this central moment depends on velocity, directly on velocity. And this is not physically, yeah, so this is a violation of Galilean invariance. So first of all, it's not the same, and then there is actually also a problem with Galilean invariance. Okay, what on earth is Galilean invariance? So Galilean invariance is the statement that each law in nature must be independent of the inertial frame of reference, in which it is stated. So if you are a physicist, you will notice that this is not completely true. And nowadays we know that we have to replace this by something that is called Lorentz invariance. Yeah. So Galilean invariance breaks down for very, very high velocities, which are close to the speed of light. Then you will see a change. But for things here down on Earth, we would usually assume that they are Galilean invariant. Now, this Lattice-Boltzmann method is not Galilean invariant, yeah, because in the relaxation of this moment, in the change, in the rate of change of this moment depends on the velocity, which is not physical. Actually, we can make this Galilean invariant very simply by, you see, if these things drop out, then our model would be Galilean invariant, yeah. But then it would mean that the relaxation rates would be all the same, and then it's no longer MRT. Then we are back at BGK. Ha! BGK is Galilean invariant. Yeah? Funny, yeah? MRT is not. So let us write this down. So here the decay of the third order moment depends on velocity, unless, yeah, here comes this big unless, all relaxation rates are the same. So then we are back in BGK, and we wanted to get out of BGK, okay? Okay, now we are wrapping a little bit up. There are two inherent problems of the multiple relaxation time Lattice-Boltzmann method. And this has, both of them has to do with the ghosts. Yeah, the ghosts are these moments of an order which do not appear directly in the Navier-Stokes equation. So ghosts are not independent. And even if orthogonalized, yeah, and this may lead to the fact that ghosts can blow up. So ghosts usually don't have a big effect as long as they are small, but if they become very big, they also have a big influence, and then they are usually a big problem. And the other thing is that the ghosts are not Galilean invariant. And so what we observe, and kind of annoyingly, is that both problems disappear if all relaxation rates are the same, so this means if we go back to BGK. So do we want this? No, we don't want this. Instead of going back to BGK because we are too stupid, we try to be clever and recognize that maybe, just maybe, these moment methods are not the right way to do it. So moments may not be the best choice of variables. Okay, and now we find, finally we arrive at how we should do it, and this is called the cumulant method. So cumulants are the variables that we are going to use now. Okay, so some kind of motivation. So we need to find independent, because we don't have them, we need to find independent variables. Because only if the variables are independent of each other, they can also decay at different rates. Yeah, think about physics. Okay, because if things are not independent, if two quantities are coupled with each other, so that one is correlated with the other, then it's not possible that one decays quickly and the other one decays slowly. Yeah. So for example, in COVID-19, the number of people infected and the number of people in hospital, they are connected to each other. So it's not possible that one vanishes very quickly and the other one doesn't. This will not happen. They are correlated quantities. They are not independent quantities. So they cannot evolve on different timescales. So variables which are not independent cannot decay independently. This is the problem. Yeah, so decay rates, and this is omega, must be coupled. And what we want to do is to uncouple them. So the first thing, in order to uncouple them, we have to find the right variables. Yeah, and we found that moments are not the right variables. Now, what do we do to find the right variables? Yeah, what is the right variables? We want them to be independent of each other. And now we have to ask, what is independence actually meaning? Yeah. Is independence orthogonality? No, we discovered that orthogonality does not lead to independence. So what instead? So independence of observable quantities. Okay, let's start with an intuitive definition of what it means. So two random variables. Let's call one X and the other one Y, for example, yeah? Are independent if the knowledge on the state of X gives no, so this is the important part, gives no information on the state of B. Not even likelihood, yeah? State of, not B, but Y. Okay, independence means that if you know everything about X, then you know nothing about Y. And if the information about X gives you any information on the probability how Y may look like, then they are not independent. That's the point. Okay, how is it in MRT? So in MRT we have a strange observation. In MRT, we find that the equilibrium of non-conserved moments typically depends on the conserved moment. And since things usually don't diverge too strongly about from their equilibrium, it means that by looking at the moment M20, you already know something about the moment M10. Yeah, so you get some information, some probability information from a higher order moment to a lower order moment. So they cannot be independent in reality. Yeah, so if the higher order moments were independent of the lower order moments, of the conserved moments, their equilibrium should not depend on the lower order moments. This is not plausible, because this means there is a coupling. And yet this is the case. Okay, now this were the bad news. So let's go to trying to solve actually our problem. And for solving our problem, we look a little bit in probability theory. Now we have this distribution F. Yeah, this distribution F. This is the joint probability distribution function for all the observable quantities of interest. And now we want to look at how does it look like if these variables are independent. Now, again, go back to two independent random variables, X and Y. And they are defined to be now independent. Independent random variables. So we know they are out there, but we don't know how they look like. We want to know how they look like. And unfortunately, we have everything on top of each other. Yeah, so we have a sum of all these variables, and what we are looking at now is what is what's about the sum of two random variables. The sum set as being the sum of x and y. So this is the sum of two variables. And now, probability theory tells us that for independent, and we are looking for independent variables, so for independent x and y, the distribution of set is given, so this will be the distribution function, distribution density function of the distribution density function of set for the variable set. This will be this integral over the entire space f of x, or the distribution of x set minus y, f the distribution of y on y dy, and this is usually written as fx, x with this star fy of y, and this is called a convolution. This is the convolution of these two distributions. So the distribution for the sum of these two variables is the convolution of the distributions of these two variables, provided that the two variables are independent of each other. And this is our condition. Okay, now we have this convolution. Convolution is very interesting because convolution, for convolution, we have a special special condition on the Laplace transform or the Fourier transform. Yeah, so what is convolution? Convolution in distribution. In distributions F is the multiplication of their Laplace transforms, Laplace or Fourier transforms. So this is a basic property of the Laplace transform. Okay, I mean, as maybe convolution in distribution F is multiplication of the Laplace transform. So the Laplace transform, this is this capital F that we've already used in the second lecture that we have. So we Laplace transform our distribution function F. So, and if we have two Laplace transform distribution functions, the sum of this variable, this is now just fx times fy. So this is very simple, yeah? Very simple property of the Laplace transform, and this is now useful for deriving new variables. Okay, let's write this down so that it doesn't get lost. So for independent random variables, the Laplace transformed probability density factors. Yeah, so there's a factorization of this F in the for the different variables. Now, In the second lecture, I know a long time ago now, we already used this this capital F. When we were talking about the generation of moments, yeah, so there's the so-called moment generating function. Moment generating function, the way we express this is if we define moments MABC, then this was equal to, now these are our lattice Boltzmann methods, moments with the Laplace transformed velocity, which we call xi a, so this is three-dimensional, this is supposed to be an epsilon, I know my writing is not nice, b, but the b derivative in epsilon, and this is supposed to be a capital zeta, c on the f of xi, so this is the entire vector at the position xi equal to zero. And actually, this implies that we can rewrite this f as the Fourier, the Taylor expansion. Yeah, so because this is a series expansion, and we can write this actually in a proper Taylor format, and the Taylor format looks like this. This is A, so A, B, C, coming from zero. So the sum over all the moments that we have. Here we have the step A, epsilon B, set C. So this is the deviation from the origin divided by the factorial, and this is on MABC. So this is nothing else than a Taylor expansion. This is a Taylor expansion where we have the Laplace transformed distribution function written in terms of their moments. Yeah. Which is, of course, the inverse of this first equation here. Okay, so now this is how we came up to moments. Now the moments are not good, yeah, because these things are not independent. Let's again, what does independence mean? As a for independent observable quantities, and I will now call these observable quantities capital CI. Now this F xi. This F xi, this is the distribution function for all of our observable quantities. And our problem is, we know there are these independent observable quantities, but we don't know them by name. We don't know what they are. And we want to find them. So the thing that we know is that they have to factor. So a factoring means, so we have here a product of for an infinite for infinite distribution functions, so for continuous distribution functions, there will be infinitely many of them. So on a discrete lattice, there will be only finite many of them, but this doesn't matter now too much. So there will be a factorization of distribution functions, fi, that depend only, that correspond only, each of them, only to one of these quantities, of the observable quantities. Yeah? Of the observable quantities that until now we don't know. So, but we know that this is the case. And now, what we are doing is we just take the logarithm of f. So just the logarithm of f. And this is, of course, so the logarithm makes from a, makes from this product, it makes a sum. It turns this into a sum and gives us log of f I, of course, as a function. So these are the fi of the ci. Okay, now we have it as a sum, and as a sum, we also have this Taylor expansion thing. Now, can we combine this? Yes, we can. We simply define new quantities for now the logarithm of this guy. So logarithm of f of xi. And now we define the sum a, b, and c from 0 to infinity. And here we have again the same, the Taylor expansion. So this is a small c, not to confuse with the capital C, a, b, small c, times capital C, a, b, c. Okay, we just define new variables, and this is now taken for the logarithm, yeah? And we can also reverse this, of course, this c, a, b, c, a, b, c. This will then, of course, be the derivatives in the eighth derivative in xi, the bth derivative in y, and the z derivative in zeta of the logarithm of f of xi at the position xi equal to 0. Now, these things are called cumulants. And you see, they are countable cumulants. And now the important thing is, by the way we defined them, by definition, cumulants are independent random variables. So, now we found our quantities that we want to relax. So now just we say what we are doing is that we take MRT. We do everything as before. MRT using cumulants instead of moments. Why? Because now these things is Galilean invariant. And of course we have the independence of the variables. So it's actually permissible to have them have different relaxation rates. So now, this looks a bit weird. Now, first of all, how to compute cumulants? Computing cumulants actually is not easy. Yeah, and this was for implementing the cumulant method, this was one of the biggest problems. So C, let's say we look at C001. This is d zeta log f of Xi, I'm not going to write this all the time now, of Xi is equal to zero. So this ends up with, if we take the chain rule here, will end up with 1 over f d set f, and this for Xi is equal to zero. Now we replace this with the moment method, with the moments, and then we find that this gives us an M01 divided by M000, and this is nothing else than VZ. Similarly, if we look at C002, this is the zeta by 2, so second derivative log f c c equal to 0. This gives us the zeta second derivative of f divided by f minus d zeta first derivative square by f square. So by applying the chain rule, and then we know that this gives us now moments, and now we can write the moments m20 minus divided by m00 minus u set square. And in fact, this leads us to the conclusion that C22 equilibrium plus C022 equilibrium plus C20 equilibrium, this together is theta, which I remind you is the temperature. Now, these things behave very interestingly, yeah? Moments were always somewhat complicated, but here we see that first cumulants are nothing else than the velocity. And this trace of second order cumulants, this is the temperature. And in fact, I don't know any more compact definition of temperature. So next time you explain to your mother, what is temperature? What physically is temperature? Physically, temperature is the trace of the second order cumulants of the distribution, of the velocity distribution. This is temperature. There is no simpler definition of temperature. And it's something that all of you know, yeah? Before you know that this is a cumulant. Okay. And the other interesting thing is that that the equilibrium of all other cumulants is zero. Because they are not allowed to depend on anything, yeah? If they don't depend on anything, so they must be zero, and this is in fact the case. Okay. Expressing cumulants in raw moments is kind of complicated. We look at the other case, namely to express cumulants in terms of central moments. So in the Lagrangian frame, so let's first look at the change of frame of reference. Uh, according. So what we are going to use is the translation rule of the Fourier. So this is the same, the Fourier or Laplace transform. So I hope that you are reasonably familiar with the Laplace and Fourier transforms. Yeah. Just as a reminder, if we have a frame, an Euler frame, and in this Euler frame we have the distribution F, and we have a Lagrange frame, then we can shift these from the Euler frame to a Laplace frame just by multiplication of U velocity times this in this inverse velocity. Yeah, this is just the rule of transformation in the Laplace frame. If you're not very familiar, then it may drop from heaven, but this is just the rule. So if you're not very familiar with the Laplace and Fourier transform, I highly suggest that you look into some textbooks about this topic, because this is kind of important. Okay, but it's not the topic of our lecture here. So cumulants. From central moments. So CABC, now again, all these derivatives. I'm looking for a more efficient way to write this down. So now this is on the logarithm of F E by the power U, here scalar product by this frequency velocity, and this is at the position equal to zero. And this can be rewritten as this derivatives part. Times minus u x. So now this is, as you see, this is a linear term. This is a linear term. So this will only make a difference in the first derivatives. Yeah? And in all higher derivatives, this part will disappear. Which means that all but order one cumulants are frame independent. And this makes absolute sense, because we said they should not depend on anything. So they should not depend on velocity. They cannot depend on velocity, so they must be frame invariant. And this means we can also write in the same way, we can write the cumulants by using the chain rule in all kinds of frames, in all frames. So we can also write it in central moments. Which of course is C002, for example, this is M. 002 divided by M000, so this is something that we have just derived, and this is equal to K to the, this is the absolutely the same thing in central moments, with the only interesting thing being that by definition, the first order cumulants, central moments, they are all zero. And this, of course, simplifies things. So means that writing cumulants in central moments is more efficient than in raw moments. Okay, let's test it with the example that we had in the beginning. Yeah, cumulants to the test, and here I mean a theoretical test, of course. Let's recall our initial problem. The problem that we had with this problem moment. The problem moment was the one that we had to modify, otherwise it would either go unstable or we would have large errors, depending how what we did. So this is the one that would cause extreme problems. This was M211. And the problem that we had was that extreme damping or instability can only be avoided if we define an n, okay, so this was just a stupid name, N21 is equal to M211 minus theta M01011. If this guy is relaxed instead of M211. So now question, what is about the cumulant, the same countable cumulant C211? Now, this cumulant C211, according to the chain rule, can be expressed as K, central moment K, 211 minus K, 200, K, 011 plus 2, K, 110 times K, 101, and this divided by rho. Now, another reminder, the result about the problem this was observed at second order in the asymptotic analysis. So, now we look at the cumulants also to second order, right? So C21 to second order. Yeah, what does this mean? So this is the the first order central moment to second order minus, and now comes all these combinations. They are even order moments. They can only have even order. So there must be a k to zero order, k to zero zero to zero order, k 0 1 1 to first order plus k 2 0 0 to second order, k 0 1 1 to zero order plus 2 k 1 1 1 0 to second order times k 1 0 1 to order 0 plus 2 k 1 1 0 to the order 0 and k 1 0 1 to the order 0, and all this divided by rho by the order of 0. Now to zero order k 1 0 0, this is 0, and this is of course also the same thing for k 1 0. I mean, this is just a permutation. And k 2 0 0 to zero order, this is nothing else than theta times rho. Okay? So this means basically that all these guys here drop out. What is this? So there I misspelled it. Here must be a 1. So this, 2, a 2, 2. So, but anyway, this drops out. And this leads to the conclusion that C21, yeah, to a second order is nothing else than K211 to second order minus theta times K011 second order. And this is, in fact, the solution that previously we found by hand. However, this is now not only valid to second order, but this is valid to any order. And it's also Galilean invariant. Yeah. So the cumulants remove this problem. And now this is all very theoretical, but has this any practical consequence? And absolutely it has. Now let me, we don't show many practical applications here, but let me show you this picture here that we have here. So now this comparison, this picture here, so it's very, it's just a picture, of course, but it's a picture of what we can stably simulate with BGK, MRT, and the cumulant method on the same grid, yeah, using the same grid resolution. So, if we define a grid Reynolds number as the Reynolds number for one grid spacing, in BGK, we can roughly simulate a grid Reynolds number of 10. A good MRT method with everything properly adjusted gets you to a grid Reynolds number of 40, and with cumulants, we can do this at least one order of magnitude better. Yeah. So, okay, we are now running really out of time. I was going to show some results. Maybe I'm skipping this to. Um to next week, so which is the, of course, the last week. So with the cumulant method, we can actually simulate real things like this. Now will this now move? With this airfoil, yeah. So we simulated here an airfoil at the Reynolds number of 1 million, and there is a porous inlay in here, and what you see is the so-called Q criterion. So all of these worms that you see here, each of these worms is one vortex. So this is the flow at Reynolds number 1 million. There is no turbulence model. There is we resolve the flow going through such pores in a porous trailing edge, which is applied to the back of a wing for reducing noise. Let us see. Okay, this I skip over this. So these are the turbulent structures that we see here. Each of these lines, almost each pixel, is a vortex itself. So these again here vortices, and I just wanted to go to this movie. I don't know whether you can actually appreciate it. Probably not, because my computer is too slow. Here you see the vortices going through this porous material, yeah, and flowing around. And I'm very sorry that my computer doesn't manage this. Here again, this is a velocity field of turbulent velocity field, Reynolds number 1 million, going through this porous material, yeah. And you see, none of this would be possible without the cumulant method. Okay, I hope you like this lecture. We have one more, which is next week. Next Friday, we'll have the last lecture in this semester. And after this, of course, we'll have our exam. So see you next week.